Welcome to Canvas Church. You are listening to our weekly celebration service message. Thank you for tuning in.
God is good. Amen. You're in John chapter 11. Last week, we had a great message in here. At least I heard it was great. I got a lot of text messages saying it was great. I'm not saying it was great because I preached it. I'm saying it was great because literally I got a lot of feedback saying, man, it was just a great message. And so praise Jesus for that. Love of coming back from vacation and just having God speak so clearly. And today is kind of going to go along with that. This is something that God's been speaking to me. As we talked last week, the message was, who is this? Talking about who is Jesus. Do you really understand who he is? Do you really understand what he's capable of? There was this point in the message as we were reading through the gospel that we discovered that the disciples really began to question. They didn't really know who he was. They didn't believe he could do something. They were totally shocked that he was able to cause the wind and the waves to stop and therefore the storm to cease and their boat not to sink. But here's the thing. I think we all go through seasons in our life where we question who God is and what he's able to do. But I believe that today in this message that God just wants to continue to show you his goodness and his greatness and show you that he can still do whatever it is you need him to do. Do you believe that this morning? Half of you, the rest of you will by the end of the message. So we're going to read John chapter 11. We're going to read 44 verses. Can you believe that? That's probably the most Bible you've read this week, but that's okay. And maybe the most Bible you've heard in church in a while. John chapter 11. We're going to start in verse 1. And we're going to read to verse 44. If you've been in church for a while, you've probably heard at least some rendition of this story. And it says this, a man named Lazarus was sick. He lived in Bethany with his sisters, Mary and Martha. This is the Mary who later poured out the expensive perfume on the Lord's feet and wiped them with her hair. That's an incredible story that's in Scripture as well. Her brother Lazarus was sick, so the two sisters sent a message to Jesus telling him, Lord, your dear friend is very sick. Now, I want you to pause right there for a moment with me because I want you to understand the full context of this story. This is not just like some of the other stories where people have heard about Jesus and they've heard that he's doing some cool stuff and some miracles, but they've never met him. The scripture here would show us that these are people that are very intimately involved with Jesus. That these are people that are his dear friends, that when Jesus was coming to that city, he would make it a point to not only go there, but to stay there, to eat with them, to build a relationship with them, so much so that the scripture says these are not just friends, but they are dear friends. These are people that are close to Jesus, okay? So here is Mary and Martha, the sisters of Lazarus, sending word to Jesus about his dear friend Lazarus. So Lazarus understands who Jesus is, has an intimate relationship with him, and the reason they're sending for Jesus is because they believe Jesus can do something about his sickness. Are you with me this morning? Verse 4. But when Jesus heard about it, he said, Lazarus' sickness will not end in death. No, it happened for the glory of God, so that the Son of God will receive glory from this. So although Jesus loved Martha, Mary, and Lazarus, he stayed where he was for the next 2 days. Finally, he said to his disciples, let's go back to Judea. Now, I want to pause there again because that part of the story doesn't really make sense to our natural minds, does it? The Bible just clarified that these are people that are very close to Jesus. These are people that he loved dearly. And when he hears the report that Lazarus is sick, listen to it now, he decides to stay a couple days longer. I don't know about you, but when you have a friend like that, come on, you unfriend him on Facebook. Are you with me? Right? Like you send a message like, hey, I'm in desperate need right now. Like, this is not going well. Things are looking really bleak. Could you come help me out? Sure. Peace out. I'll be there in a couple days. All right? But why is he doing that? Why is he? Well, the Bible kind of lets us in because something great is about to take place. That God is going to use this for his glory, for the demonstration of his power to show the people what he's capable of. So now I want you to hear this today. Jesus loves you very, very much. Jesus, man, loves you. And so if you're sitting here today saying, if he loved me, why hasn't he answered me? If he loved me, why did this happen? If he loved me, why did this take place? Know this, Jesus loves you, but Jesus is all about his kingdom. And in his love for you, he wants to demonstrate something that will just blow your mind. Are you with me? Jesus loves these three, so much so that he waited a little bit longer. Verse 8, but his disciples objected. Rabbi, they said, only a few days ago, people in Judea were trying to stone you. Are you going there again? Jesus replied, there are 12 hours of daylight every day. During the day, people can walk safely. They can see because they have the light of this world. But at night, there is danger of stumbling because they have no light. Then they said, our friend Lazarus has fallen asleep, but now I will go and wake him up. Totally different message in there. Hit it another time. Verse 12. The disciples said to the Lord, if he's sleeping, he will soon get better. They thought Jesus meant Lazarus was simply sleeping, but Jesus meant Lazarus had died. So he told them plainly, Lazarus is dead. And for your sakes, this is horrible, by the way. And for your sakes, I'm glad. What kind of a friend is this? Jesus, help us. For your sakes, I was glad I wasn't there, for now you will really believe. Come, let us go see him. Thomas, nicknamed the twin, said to his fellow disciples, let's go too and die with Jesus. Verse 17, when Jesus arrived at Bethany, he was told that Lazarus had already been in the grave for 4 days. Bethany was only a few miles down the road from Jerusalem, and many of the people had come to console Martha and Mary in their loss. When Martha got word that Jesus was coming, she went to meet him, but Mary stayed in the house, probably because she was ticked off. Martha said to Jesus, Lord, if only you had been here, my brother would have not died. But even now I know that God will give you whatever you ask. Jesus told her, your brother will rise again. Martha said, well, I know he'll rise again in the last day. Jesus told her, I am the resurrection and the life. That is a great place to say amen. I am the resurrection and the life. Anyone who believes in me will live. Even after dying, everyone who lives in me and believes in me will never, ever die. Do you believe this, Martha? Yes, Lord, she told him. I've always believed you are the Messiah, the Son of God who has come into the world, a world from God. Then she returned to Mary. She called Mary aside from the mourners and told her, the teacher is here and he wants to see you. So Mary immediately went to see him. Jesus stayed outside the village at the place where Martha met him. When the people who were at the house consoling Mary saw her leave so hastily, they assumed she was going to Lazarus's grave to weep. So they followed her there. When Mary arrived and saw Jesus, she fell at his feet and said, Lord, if only you had been here, my brother would not have died. I believed you could have done something about that. When Jesus saw her weeping and saw the other people wailing with her, a deep anger welled up within him. I don't know if you've ever asked yourself this question, but when's the last time you ticked God off? He's ticked. A deep anger welled up within him. And he was deeply troubled. Where have you put him? He asked them. They told him, Lord, come and see. Then Jesus wept. The people who were standing nearby said, see how much he loved him. I want to pause right there because this shortest verse in all of Scripture right there, Jesus wept. I've looked at that and I've studied it and I've thought about it. And some people say, well, Jesus wept because he loved Lazarus so much and Lazarus is now dead. Others say that Jesus wept not over Lazarus, but over the lack of faith of the people. Because Jesus already knew what he was going to do. And Jesus knew he was capable of doing it. He's angry. He's weeping. And they said, well, it's because he loved him so much. But some said, this man healed a blind man. Couldn't he have kept Lazarus from dying? That ticked Jesus off even more. Verse 38. Jesus was still angry as he arrived at the tomb, a cave with a stone rolled across its entrance. Roll the stone aside, Jesus told them. But Martha, the dead man's sister, protested, Lord, he has been dead for 4 days. The smell will be terrible. Jesus responded, didn't I tell you that you would see the glory of God if you believe? So they rolled the stone aside. Then Jesus looked up to heaven and said, Father, thank you for hearing me. You always hear me, but I said it loud enough for the sake of all the people standing here. Don't you love those conversations? Parents, you ever had those conversations with one another before? But you have it loud enough so your kids can hear it? Babe, I'm telling you right now, if they act up one more time, I'm gonna, you all had those before, right? That's one of these right here. But I said it for the sake of all of those standing here so that they will believe you sent me. Then Jesus shouted, Lazarus, come out. And the dead man came out, his hands and feet bound in grave clothes, his face wrapped in a headcloth. And Jesus told them, unwrap him and let him go. I want to talk to you for the next few moments on he can still do it. God, we thank you so much for your word. God, we thank you that your word is awesome. God, your word is so life-giving. And God, I pray that in the next few moments that we're here gathered around the context of John chapter 11, that you would speak to us. God, you would speak to us. You'd speak to us where we're at. And God, we walk out of this place believing that you can still do it. You can do anything, that nothing is impossible with you. God, I pray you'd help me now in the next few moments that we have together to help me create an environment for people to discover your son Jesus, know your incredible love, and realize the amazing plan that you have for them. In Jesus' mighty name, amen. Amen. I mentioned last week, and we had just gotten back from vacation. I think we rolled in on Wednesday. And so a week and a half ago, got back from vacation. When we go away, we like to go to Washington. That's where my wife's from. That's where I'm from. And we like going up there. When we go up there, we get to go on the boat. We get to go water skiing. Anybody ever water ski? No, you need to try it. Okay. Wakeboarding, different just water sports. It's so much fun. And so we were up there, and we were up there with Katie's parents. And Katie's mom is 72 years young. Come on, somebody. How many of you guys like the way I phrased that right there? She's 72 years young, and she still loves the water sports, and she still loves, and it's so awesome every time we go up there and we see her ski, and because she just gets younger and younger every year, because we still got, and here's the thing, I watch my wife and I watch my daughters, and there's always a conversation around it, like this last summer when we were just there just a couple weeks ago, and she pops right up at the age of 72, and she is just cutting across the water like crazy, and they're just sitting there awestruck by what she's doing. And then all of a sudden I hear my girls talking like, oh my gosh, I can't believe she can still do that. I can't believe she can still do that. Now, they don't say it loud enough to where she can hear it. Come on, somebody. So if she's watching today, now she knows. Sorry, girls, I blew it for you. And I'll never forget my wife looking at me saying, man, I hope when I'm 72, I can do that. And I thought to myself, like, well, your mom is doing it right now. Like, what would give you this thing? Well, I hope I can do that. Now, I get it. As we age, there are just things that we can't do anymore. Are you with me? Or we try to do them, and the next week we're recovering. Come on, somebody. Right? I get that. I understand there's some natural, you know, limitations as we get older. But I think that far too many of us look at somebody doing something at a certain age thinking, man, I hope I can do that. Almost like there's a time expiration date on things you can do. Like, I hope when I get older, I can do that. One of my things is I want to be playing basketball until the day I'm put in the grave. Come on, somebody. So I don't care. I don't care if I play in a cane league. Come on, somebody. I'll be hobbling on that cane. Pass me the ball. I'll whack somebody with my cane. Come on, somebody. And those that have played with me are like, yeah, he will take that cane and whack somebody. You know, maybe you're like into working out. You're like, I hope I can run those many miles. Like, we put this time expiration date on things. And here's the thing. I think far too many of us carry that same concept into our spiritual walk with Jesus. That I don't know what it is, but it's like when you first come to Jesus, it's like you're this little kid and you can believe he can do anything. It's like there is no limitations. You think back to the stories, you're like, oh yeah, he can do that. But it seems like the older we get or the more we grow and whatnot, it seems like, oh yeah, he can do that for them maybe, not for me. It's almost like we put a time expiration date on what God can do. Is somebody with me this morning? But I believe that today that God wants to remind you once again that there is nothing outside of his realm, nothing outside of his scope, that there is nothing too difficult for him. That there is nothing impossible, that with God, all things are possible. The thing you're looking at right now that you're like, you know what? I guess if he would have showed up in this moment, it may have worked out. I guess if maybe something would have took place over here, then maybe that could have taken place. But now you've just kind of written it off and you're like, timestamp. But I believe that today that God wants to remind you, come on somebody, that he can do it. He can get you out of any circumstance. He can get you out of any situation. There's nothing too big for him. There's nothing too great for him. All things are possible for him. Whatever it is, whatever you're looking at right now, he can still do it. Now, I want to look back at this narrative today, and I want you to understand that John chapter 11, in the context of Scripture, it is a narrative. It is talking about something Jesus did. This is not like a Bible lesson. This is not like, hey, this would make for a great object lesson or story. This really happened. This is a narrative for us to read, but I believe with all my heart that as we read the narratives in the Gospels, that there's prophetic moments for us. Are you with me? That there are things that God wants to speak directly to us, through us, and for us. And so what I want to do is I want to simply look at these five statements that Jesus makes when he shows up at this town to his dear friend Lazarus. Now, I don't know what it would be like to be Lazarus, to be close to Jesus and to be his dear friend, to be lying on the bed at the brink of death and thinking, man, Jesus, if only you show up, if only you get here, if only you show up. There was this faith for this moment, and it's the same faith that even his sisters have. When Jesus hears about it, he delays. But he explains to him why he delays. He delays because he's about to do something that's just going to blow their minds. And I wish God was on our timetable. Anybody else? I wish that when I prayed something here, because I know he hears me, the Bible says in Psalm 116, he bends low to hear my prayers. So when I lift my voice to him and I'm talking with him and I'm having a conversation with him, there's never a question on whether or not he hears me. God hears you. God hears everything you utter. Matter of fact, the Bible says that you're going to be held accountable for every idle word you speak. So it's not just the prayers he hears, it's everything that comes forth out of your mouth. He hears you. But yet God's timetable is so much different than our timetable. And it's not, he's not doing it because he doesn't love us. He's doing it because he loves us so much. He wants to show us how amazing he really is. He explains to them, like, hey, something great's got to happen. He rolls into town. And it's not like he's in a hurry. Did y'all see that? He waited a couple of days. And then he strolls into town, but he doesn't even go all the way into town. He just kind of walks in. The audacity of Jesus. He didn't come running. He just came strolling into town. Some conversations happen. Finally, the first statement he makes to them, he says this, he said, where have you put him? Where have you put him? I think this is such a prophetic utterance for us this morning. Where have you put him? Where have you put Lazarus? Obviously, he's been dead for 4 days. Jesus would understand Jewish custom, that in Jewish custom, when somebody dies, you bury them the day they die. You don't wait. You don't hold on to the body. The day they die is the day you embalm, the day you wrap, and the day you put into the tomb. So Jesus would already know that Lazarus is put away. And so I have to think that Jesus isn't just asking location, but that today Jesus would be asking us this: where is it that you buried your faith? Where is that place that you stopped believing that I could do anything? Where is that place that all of a sudden, hey, if you would have showed up 4 days ago, then Lazarus, you probably could have kept him from death. But now that Lazarus is dead, well, I think it's over. There's not much you can do, Jesus. Where is that place in your life where you can go back and say, that's the place I stopped believing. That's the day I buried the dream. That's the day I buried my faith. That's the day where God could do this, but this is a little bit outside of his realm. Where is that place for you? Where is the place that you buried your faith? Where is that place that you stopped believing God? Because just days ago, you were calling for Jesus. And then you stopped calling and you went ahead and buried the very thing you wanted him to touch. How many of us in our spiritual walk do that we come to this place, well, Jesus didn't show up, Jesus didn't answer, and I guess, but Jesus says, hey, show me that area. Show me that, but I want to touch you in the place that you stopped believing. I want to touch you in the place where you buried your faith and you thought it was over. I want to go there. I want to go deep, and I want to touch that place, and I want to go and resurrect something. Show me. He wants you to show him. Where is it? You lead him to that place. You know where to. He already knows where it's at. He already knew Lazarus was dead. He already knows you stopped believing. He already knows you written it off. But he wants you to show him. Take me to that place of pain. Take me to that place. I remember going through this in ministry many, many times over. I remember early, I wasn't even early on, I'd been doing a youth ministry for probably close to 10 years. And I was working at a church, and man, our youth ministry was blowing up. I took my girls back a couple years ago to show them this youth ministry we started in Vegas, and things were just popping, man. It was so good. But for whatever reason, we had I don't know what you call them, an advisor come in and critique all of the ministries of the church. Don't you love critics? And somehow his survey ended up on my desk. The pastor's name was Ben as well, and my name is Ben. I don't know if that was a mistake or what, but it ended up, and so I thought it was for me, and so I started flipping through it. And I started reading, well, because I'm a B, I'm one of the very first ones in this thing, and I flip it open, I start reading, and it's this analysis of me and my youth ministry. And I started reading, and it was basically just blasting how he's kind of doesn't know what he's doing. He'll never, this is the phrase that stuck out to me, he'll never be able to have a youth ministry over 150. Even though at the time our youth ministry was like 275. But for whatever reason, that got in my spirit. And all of a sudden I realized, literally I was reading, I was like, I don't think this is meant for me. And I closed it, and I was like, took it to this. I said, hey, I think this is like, how'd you end up with that? I was like, you put it on my desk, jerk. But you know how many times in ministry that little voice has popped up inside? You'll never. And it's almost like it doesn't matter what God had spoken to me and promised me. That voice just kept. And for me, that was the day that I buried Lazarus. That was the day I said, you know what? Yeah, I guess God can't do. But it wasn't just there. I mean, there were times, even as we started this church, those that have been on this journey with us for a while, and you know how many different locations we've been and how many moves we've been through, and this thing happened and that thing happened. And I remember being in a portable, I think we were still in a school at that time, weren't even in a theater, and I just kind of looked at myself one day and said, you know, we're going to be portable for the rest of our life. I didn't say that to the rest of my team, because they would have all abandoned me like the disciples abandoned Jesus, you know. But I looked in the mirror and said, you know what? We're going to be portable. What is put you similar? Like, what do you mean portable, Pastor? We would set up and tear down every Sunday. Yeah, it was awesome. And I just looked at him and said, I guess this is it. Jesus just has to keep coming in and reminding. What is it for you? Where is it that you buried Lazarus? See, is your faith centered around circumstances? and situations? Is your faith centered around a message or is your faith still centered around the fact that Jesus Christ is the way, the truth, and the life? Show me where you put him. Take me there. I believe that Jesus wants you. I can't lead you there. He knows exactly where it is. But where is the place that you said, well, I guess he can't heal me of that. I guess he can't touch my son or daughter of that. I guess he can't redeem that. I guess he can't restore my marriage. I guess he can't is somebody with me this morning? You take him there. You show him that place, and he gets there still filled with anger, the Bible says. He gets to the place. He hears the people talking. Well, if he would have showed up a few days ago, he probably could have, you know, kept Lazarus from dying because he opened up some blind eyes. That was pretty incredible. And Jesus is hearing the dialogue, and he's filled with anger. And this is what he says. This is the second prophetic statement. He says, roll the stone away. Roll the stone aside. And I don't know if you could hear it in the text, but this is the place where everybody would gasp. If you're watching the movie, that's the place. Like, do what? You want us to roll the... As a matter of fact, the sister of Lazarus says, hold on a second. Jesus, no, because he's been in there for 4 days. And this witch says, it's going to stink. The body is decomposing. It's going to smell. Are you sure that's what you want us to do? You want us to roll the stone? I mean, if you showed up 4 days ago, it would have been good. If you would have showed up in my mess just a little bit sooner, it wouldn't have smelled so bad. Come on, somebody. If you would have showed up in my situation a few days earlier, it wouldn't have been this messy. Now you want me to what? You want me to roll the stone away so that is exposed? And Jesus is like, I want you to roll the stone away. And I believe prophetically today, Jesus would look at you. Thanks for taking me to the place. Now let's get to work. Thanks for showing me the place that you were wounded. Thank you for showing me the place that you buried your faith. Now it's time to go to work. I want you to roll the stone away. I want you to remove the obstacles that are keeping you from experiencing the miracle and the breakthrough that I have for you. Oh, but it's messy in there. It's messy in there. Listen, Jesus is not afraid of your stink. He's not afraid of your mess. He is not afraid of what's on the other side. I think too many of us stop right there in church specifically. Like, I'm here. Jesus, this is there. I'm hurt. Okay. Why don't you go ahead and forgive them? Whoa. Well, we ain't rolling that stone. Why don't you go ahead and step back into that ministry that, oh, hold on a second. No. We're not rolling that stone. Why didn't you go ahead? I know you felt like you got burned by the last church or the last ministry, although no church has ever burnt anybody. People in the church may have, but come on, the Church of Jesus Christ is beautiful and it doesn't burn anybody. But why don't you try giving of your finances? Whoa. We're not rolling that stone away. It's messy. Roll the stone away. Mary, Lord, the body. Brings up the third statement. But Lord, the body. And Jesus looks at, remember, he's angry. Did y'all see that in the story? He's mad. And he looks at her and said, didn't I tell you? And I'm pretty sure that's the way he said it. Anybody ever been angry before? I mean, he's there. You called me. I hear the chatter going on. Roll the stone away. But it's going to... No, I tell you. This is what he says. Didn't I tell you that you would see God's glory if you believe? Didn't I tell you? I think this third prophetic statement here is a reminder of the thing that God told you. You might have buried your faith somewhere. You might have buried the dream. You might have buried the promise. You might have thought, man, if he had showed up, you know, in this situation or circumstance, then maybe that could have happened, but not anymore. And Jesus is talking to you right now prophetically saying, no, didn't I give you a promise? Didn't I tell you I was going to do something in and through your life? Didn't when you stood at that altar and you looked that other person in, and it's still, I'm using this because it's so fresh because I just celebrated 25 years of bliss. Come on, somebody. Just tell my wife, hey, he described your marriage as bliss. And when you looked into each other's eyes and said, for better, for worse, for richer, for poor, when you stood there and took that vow and I promised I would cover your marriage and you promised, what about the other promises, God? What about the promise for that ministry? What about the promise for that health, that healing? What has God spoken to you? I believe he'd look at you today like, didn't I tell you? Didn't I promise you something? Didn't I tell you this was going to happen? You know how many times in my spiritual journey and even in the planting of this church where, man, I had a whole journal of things God was going to do. Why is it on the front end of things, man, we're so excited, right? And then we get into it and it's like we forget everything, right? It's I coach basketball. I love coaching basketball. About to start up a new season. So excited about it. Going to be coaching this girls team. But I see it happen every time we go through it in practice and we go through the plays. And I'm like, oh my gosh, they're crushing it. And then we get in a game and it's like, what are you doing? Didn't I tell you? Cut. Didn't I tell you? Bucks out. What is wrong with you? What are you doing? It's like they forget everything. But you know what? I think that's where Jesus is at right now in the story. Didn't I tell you? Roll the stone away now. Woman, do it. Didn't I tell you that if you just believe? What promise? Can you go back there and wait a second? I have a whole journal, and in this ministry season, there'll be times it's like the journal never even exists, and the things that God, I don't think I heard from God. That was somebody else. And all of a sudden, God comes through, and I'm pulling the journal back. Yeah, I wrote about that. I knew he was going to do it. Man, just, didn't I tell you? Might not be on your timetable, but listen to me. He's gonna do it. Not because you're good enough. Not because you served long enough. He's gonna do it because he's faithful to his word. He's gonna do it because he said he would do it. And here's the thing you need to understand. If he promised it to you and he spoke it to you, and I got so many stories, but if he spoke it to you and promised to you, but you don't want to get on board with it, he's still gonna do it, but he's just gonna do it through somebody else. So you might as well just get on board with what he's doing and be a part of it, because it's amazing. Didn't I tell you I was going to do it? I'm going to do it because I said I was going to do it. Say, roll the stone away. And Jesus, he doesn't go in. Jesus doesn't go in. Instead, this is where he shouts with passion. Lazarus, come out. And I'm in agreement with every other scholar and every other theologian that believes he had to name Lazarus. Because if he had not named Lazarus and just said, come out, then every dead thing would have begun to rise, because everything must submit to the word of Jesus. Lazarus, come out. Come out. And at the very voice, the very word of Jesus, the decomposition begins to reverse. The smell begins to leave. And a dead man begins to get up. Now go back in the scriptures. When they buried somebody, it wasn't just like put them in a nice suit, put them in a coffin, and put them in. They were wrapped in grave clothes. Y'all know what I'm talking about. Now when I say wrapped, I don't mean like Frankenstein, like they could, you know, like each individual leg was wrapped and arm was wrapped. I mean, you ever seen a mummy? No, of course you haven't. On TV, have you ever seen a mummy? Lazarus! No one went in. Jesus didn't go in. Lazarus, come out. How does a dead man wrapped as a mummy come out? And I've decided, any way you can. I don't know if he was placed up on, like, you know, like you ever seen those, you know, on one of those things, and he was leaning like this, and he just was like. Could be. Don't know. I don't know if they like had him on like a table. I should have brought a table in for an analogy. I might need a chiropractor after this. I don't know if he was mummified and he was just like, good thing I did my ab workout this week. And he was like, I should have done more ab workouts. And he's like, come in. I don't know. I don't know if maybe he was like, did they have him laying on the ground? Come out. I'm on my way. I don't know. All I know is that he started coming. Couldn't see a thing. But following the voice. Because faith comes by hearing, and hearing by the word of God. And he follows the voice. Because we walk by faith, not by sight. Lazarus comes rolling out, hopping out, falling out. See, there's so many people that think that before I go to church, I got to get free. Before I go to church, I better get cleaned up a little bit. Before I go to church, I should probably take care of some stuff. Lazarus, come out. Not Lazarus. Is that I'm bound, but I'm going to the voice. And you see, when you come to church, see, you're going to come to Canvas Church, you're not going to walk into like super like pretty. I'm not saying you people aren't pretty. You people are beautiful. But you're not going to, here's the thing. People at Canvas aren't coming to church like this. Oh, it's Sunday. I'm so glad it's Sunday. Can't wait to worship. And pastor's messages are amazing. And pastor's messages are amazing. Okay, just check. Now you come to Canvas Church, you're like, I'm on my way. I'm almost there. Don't start worship without me. I'm coming. I'm on my way. I'm getting up. Getting up because I heard his voice. I'm getting up. That's how we come to Canvas Church. We get there any way we can. I had somebody, they came to church and they loved it. I said, awesome, you coming back? They're like, no. Serious conversation. I'm like, why? They're like, I just wanted to see a few more hip people there. I'm like, what? You want to see my hip? That's what it takes to get you to church. There you go. What do you mean you didn't see it? Yeah, I'm like hipsters? Yeah, I'm hipster. Like, I'm sorry. I'm too busy dealing with my stuff right now. I'm sorry, I'm too busy just following the voice of Jesus. I'm sorry, I don't look the part. I'm sorry I showed up in a t-shirt, multicolored, in jeans. I'm sorry that we're not hip enough. I'm sorry, we're just trying to get to the voice of Jesus. And the day that you hear him call your name is the day you come out. Not fully free. Here he is, Lazarus, come out. What do you need to come out of today? Come out of your sin. Come out of your dysfunction. Come out of your despair. Come out of your anxiety. Come out of your depression. Come out of your addiction. Come out of your pornography. Come out of your lust. Today is the day you can do that, because the day is the day he has said, hey, come out. But pastor, I feel like I'm all bound up. Then start hopping. Pastor, I don't know if I... Then start rolling. Pastor, I don't know. Then just get there any way you can, because he wants to set you free. Or you can choose to stay there. You can choose to lay there. You can choose. They rolled the stone away. Lazarus, come now. I'm good. Or you can choose to come out. Nobody went in. Nobody went in and picked him up and brought him out and said, look, he's alive. No. Lazarus somehow made his way out. And here's the greatest thing we can do in church, is when we see people coming in. What's going on with that? What's their issue? What's their problem? The greatest thing we can do is stop judging and start loving. Which brings me to the last prophetic statement of this message. Unwrap him and let him go. Five statements. Unwrap him and let him go. Church, they rolled in, they hopped in, they got here. Unwrap him and let him go. Give him the gospel. Give him love. Give him Jesus. Give him the gifts of the Spirit. Get involved. Unwrap him and let him go. Man, the job of the church right here. Jesus did everything he's going to do to raise people from death to life, to take people from sinner to saint, to take people that are on a road to hell to a road to heaven. He's done everything. Listen, man, they are there. They are hopping in. They are rolling in. They are just doing everything they can to follow the voice of Jesus. And it is the job of the church to come and say, hey, I got you. Let's take this off right now. Hey, I got you. Let's unwrap those ears. Let's unwrap those eyes. Let's unbound those feet. Let's unbound those hands. And let's begin to do this thing together. But where in your life have you buried the dream? Where in your life did you stop believing he could do it? Today, I hear the voice of the Heavenly Father saying, come out. Come out. Who are you today? Come out. Don't stay in that despair any longer. Don't stay in that hopelessness any longer. Don't stay in that addiction any longer. Don't stay in that dysfunction any longer. Don't stay in that place of hurt and bitterness and unforgiveness any longer. Get out. because today, Jesus can still do it. Lord, we thank you so much for your word. And we thank you that your word is awesome. God, it's amazing. And Lord, I pray right now. Can you do me a favor? Can you just stand to your feet before you make your way into the gymnasium and sign up for a ministry and get plugged in more vitally to the local church? I believe with all my heart that this is the prophetic message for our church. And he wants to let you know he can still do it. So I want you to do me, if I want you to close your eyes, right? Just close your eyes for a moment. Because there's some of you here today and you've buried your faith. Some of you here today and you buried your faith and you thought to yourself, man, if he would have showed up a month ago, if he would have showed up a week ago, if he would have showed up last year, if he would have showed up in this circumstance, this situation, then I believe he could have done something. And he would say to you today, I can still do it. I can still do it. I can still do it. There's somebody in here, and I'm talking, it's been years, you've been believing for something. And I can't give you the why he hasn't done it. But I can tell you he loves you. And I believe that if you just get your eyes off of the thing you want him to do and put your eyes on him, he's going to show you that he is the resurrection and the life. He is the resurrection. He's not just able to resurrect something. He is the resurrection. He's not just able to bring something to life. He is life. He is healing. He is restoration. He is provision. He is hope. He is all that you need. I feel like there's somebody in here and you've been struggling in your marriage. I don't know how long you've been married. Maybe it's a year, maybe it's 20, but you've been struggling in your marriage. And I believe that Jesus today would say, get your eyes off of your spouse and your eyes off of your problem. Get your eyes on me. And I'm going to bring wholeness, and I'm going to bring help, and I'm going to bring healing. Where's the thing? Where would you bury it? My son is sick. My daughter's sick. They've been diagnosed with this. They've been diagnosed with this. They said that about them. They said that about her. I guess we're going to learn to live with. Or do I still believe in a God that can do anything? It's time to get out. It's time to believe that he can still do it. So here's what I'm going to do. I'm going to say a simple prayer. And then I know a lot of the ministry team has to go and get ready for the ministry team fair in the gym. There's air conditioning going. It's cool in there. Go hang out. Check out the ministries. But when I get done praying, I'm just going to open up this front here. And if you need prayer for anything, I'm just going to be up here and I'm going to pray for you and believe in faith that God's going to meet you where you're at. God, we thank you so much for today. God, we thank you that there's nothing that's too difficult for you, that you can get us out, that you can still do it. The God of the impossible. So Lord, I pray today for every person in this room. I pray that you'd meet them where they're at. I pray that they'd be willing to lead you to that place where they buried their faith. That you'd remind them that you are the resurrection and the life. Hallelujah. Touch bodies today. Heal people. Matter of fact, right now, just your eyes closed. You're here today, and you need healing in your body. I believe that he wants to heal you. Just with your eyes closed, I want to know who I'm praying for. If that's you, just shoot your hand in the air. You need healing right now in your body. Come on. Come on. Yep. Lift it up. There's got to be something in you that might. Okay, good. Okay, just keep your hand up. Lord, right now, we thank you that you are Jehovah Rapha, our healer and our health. And God, maybe some of us buried our faith saying, well, I believed long enough. I don't know if he can do it. God, I pray that today that you would show up, Lord, without a hand touching them. The Holy Spirit, you would just descend upon them right now, and you would bring health and you'd bring healing in Jesus' mighty name. That you would come and you'd bring health and healing right now in Jesus' mighty name. God, we thank you for the diagnosis of the doctor. God, we thank you for all of that. But Lord, we look to you today and we say, would you be our healer and our health? Bring healing right now into our physical bodies. Lord, I pray for those that are dealing with some emotional, Lord God, things. Lord, I pray right now, healing in their mind, healing right now in Jesus' mighty name. Hallelujah. Lord, we love you and we thank you in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. Hey, if you need prayer for anything, come on up. I'm going to pray with you. Hey, don't miss next week. A good friend of mine is coming and has a message you do not want to miss. It's going to be fire. Get here. Bring a friend. I'm telling you, his testimony is incredible. Make sure you're here. On your way out, come on, go through the gym. Grab a popsicle. Sign up for ministry. Get your little thing filled out so that you can get some raffle tickets. God bless you. If you need prayer for anything, come on up. I want to pray with you. I want to pray for you. God bless.